Hey everyone, welcome back to my videos on discrete-time Markov chain. So in this video, I'm going to do same as in the previous one, give you one more example of application to show you how we can, in practice, compute the mean recurrence time and prove that a discrete-time Markov chain is positive recurrence, and how to find the stationary distribution if indeed the Markov chain is positive recurrence. So here is the example we are going to look at. So in this example, we assume that Julie goes to the movie. Every day she goes to a movie with a probability Pm that is equal to 1 minus 1 over m plus 1. If the last time she went to the movies was exactly n days ago. So I just briefly explain that I chose some kind of monotone function. You see that Pm is monotone with respect to n. It's just to model the fact that if it's already a long time that Julie didn't go to the movie, she feels more and more the need to take a break. So this probability of her going to the movies keep increasing over time if, you know, as long as she didn't go to see a movie again. And the goal of this problem is just to find the expected value of the time between two consecutive movies. So it's clearly about finding some mean recurrence time, but we need to design a proper Markov chain to be able to answer the question. So to solve this problem, the Markov chain we need to consider this time is not completely natural, but what is going to work is to define the following process. So we call xn the number of days, the number of days, including day n, since Alice last watched a movie. So basically what we are doing is we keep track of, we just record the last time she watched a movie, and then each time she's going to watch again a movie, the Markov chain is back to state zero. So you see zero is in the state space here, because if she watches a movie on day n, that means that on day n, the last time she watched a movie, because we include day n, is day n itself, so the last time she saw it, like the number of days since she last saw a movie was just zero, okay? But the process can also increase. If she spends some amount of time without going to the movies, then the process is going from 0 to 1, from 1 to 2, and so on, and is going to increase over time. And each time she goes to watch a movie again, we are back to state 0. So to understand better those transition probabilities, I'm going to move to another room and use a calendar. So to understand the process xn, let's assume, for instance, that Alice goes to the movie on Sunday, then again Wednesday and Friday during the week. And let's look at first the states of the process. So if you look at Sunday, when was the last time she watched a movie, but Sunday included? Well, because she's watching a movie on Sunday, that's the last time she watched a movie was 0 days ago. So you are in state zero here. Then on Monday, she doesn't watch any movie, so that cannot be state zero. The last time she watched a movie was 1 day ago, was Sunday, so here we are in state one. And we keep increasing like that. So on Tuesday, she doesn't watch any movie again, so that's 2 days ago that she watched a movie, so we are in state two. But then here, at the opposite, she's watching a movie again. So the last time she watched a movie on Wednesday, given that she's watching a movie on Wednesday, is again back to zero. And then you keep going like this, one, zero, one, and so on. So in general, if you mark by a cross each day she's watching a movie, then those days are state zero. So in fact, the expected amount of time between movies is exactly the expected amount of time between, expected amount of time to the first time of return in state zero, given that you start from state zero, that's the mean recurrence time. So that's the goal of the prime. The prime is in fact to compute the mean recurrence time at state zero. And so now hopefully you understand better the state space. Now, next question, we can also write the transition probabilities. So here, if you are, so we don't know the probability that she's in state zero on Sunday because we would need the information about what was the state on Saturday. But now we can compute this, we can look at the probability of this transition. We know that in this case, if she watched a movie the day before, then there is a 50% chance that she's going to watch a movie again or not. It's this P and 1 minus P. So we have this transition with probability 1/2. Then at the opposite, the probability that you keep increasing is going to be less than that. Okay, the probability that she stays longer without watching a movie keep increasing, and it's like 1 over the number of days. So that's going to be here a transition 1/3. Okay, then what about this one? Well, you go from state 2, we would go to state 3 following the same pattern with probability 1/4. So the probability that she's back at 0 is going to be instead a 3/4. And so on. So here again, from 0 to 1, this is a 1/2. And here we can rewrite this one. We go from 1 to 2 with probability 1/3. So if we don't go to 2 and 0 instead, that should happen with probability 2/3. So here we have a 2/3. And so on. So now that we better understand the process and the transition probabilities, let's go back to the whiteboard to write those equations. So now that you understand the problem better, we are back to the whiteboard to write the equations. So first, I'm going to draw the directed graph of the process. So we have all the states like this. We start from state 0. And what we saw is that every day, Alice decides not to go to the cinema for one more day. We are going to go to the next state. So we have all those transitions. And we also know that each time she's going to decide to finally go to the cinema, we are back to state 0. So we see that from our reasoning with the calendar that every day she's watching a movie corresponds to a day in state 0. Okay, that's some important observation. So eventually, you see that it's xn is equal to 0 if and only if she goes to see, she goes to watch a movie on day n. So this means that the time between consecutive movies corresponds to the mean recurrence time at state 0. So we start from state 0, we go through those errors, and we want to know how long it's going to take in average to go back to 0. So the problem here is really to compute expected value starting from 0 of t0, which is the mean recurrence time at state 0. That's the goal. And so what we saw with the calendar is that each time, so if she watched a movie on, let's say, day n minus 1, okay, then n xn minus 1 is equal to 0. Xn and xn is going to be again 0 with probability p1. Okay, she decides, and in general, if it's n days that she didn't see a movie, so we have to be careful with this transition also, there is a little shift between n and the index here. If it's on a given day that's already m days she didn't watch a movie, so that's the state at time n, let's say, then in the n plus 1, then the number of days since she last saw a movie becomes like m plus 1, And so that means that she's going to decide to watch a movie with probability PM plus one, not PM, PM plus one. So from state M, we are back to state zero with probability PM plus one. And I'm not going to write the other transition. Now we have the general form of the transition from any state M its plus one here, sorry. We have the transition from any state M to back to state zero. And from any state, there is only one other transition that's going to the next integer. And so this one, for instance, occurs with probability 1 minus PM plus 1. So here we have a full description of the process. Now to do some algebra, we need to put those numbers in a matrix, the transition matrix. So the transition matrix here is going to look like this. So first, we see that we stay in state zero with probability P1. P1 is equal to 1/2, so we have a 1/2 here. Then at the opposite, we go to the next state with probability 1/2 again, and we have only zeros here. And then in general, if you look at the first column, if you increase the time she went to see, since the last time she went to see a movie, then you also increase the probability that she will decide to go back to watch a movie. So you go back to state zero, so with those probabilities, and you can easily check that they are equal to 2/3 here. And then you have a 3/4 and 4/5 and so on. Okay? Then after you only have zeros there, below the diagonal, and then just on the diagonal and below the diagonal, and just above the diagonal that corresponds to the transition probabilities to go to a state to the next one, you are going to have, well, whatever you need so that the sum is equal to 1, and that's going to give you 1/3, 0, 0, then 1/4, and so on, 1/5, and this goes on forever. The matrix is in fact infinite. Okay, so now because the state space is infinite, it's not clear whether the process is positive or recurrent or not, but clearly our intuition is that because those transition probabilities, like from higher state, keep increasing, that's likely that this mean recurrence time should be finite. And again, using the theorems we saw last time, this means that if the mean recurrence time here is finite, this means that zero is positive recurrence. And so it's clear also that the process is irreducible. So indeed, the whole Markov chain should be positive recurrence. Now, this doesn't give us the exact value of this expected value. So we need to do a little bit of algebra. And here, to solve the system, you observe that we want to solve to find the stationary distribution. That's how we get these values. We said that this one is equal to 1 divided by pi 0, so we need to find pi and extract pi 0 from that. You see that to find pi, we need to solve the system pi p equals pi. And to solve this system, so you see that it's the same as pi p minus identity is equal to 0, but clearly p minus identity does not define a bijection. Because if you look at this minus identity, then you are going to clearly see that you can find a linear combination of both columns such that you obtain exactly this column, okay? And so for this reason, it's enough to find your set of solutions. That's enough to only write all the equations except for the first column again. So we can ignore this first column because that's the most complicated one. And eventually we are going to find our system anyway. So here, to solve those equations, you start by writing that 1/2, so this column, scalar product with the vector pi, gives you a 1/2 of pi 0 that should be equal to pi 1. So we get pi 0 divided by 2 is equal to pi 1. Then the next column tells you that pi 1 over 3 is equal to pi 2. then 1/4 of pi 2 is equal to pi 3. And so on. Okay? So now I don't need this anymore. I can also erase this graph. So remember, the goal is to find this, so we want pi 0. Here, so to solve this thing, I'm going to again write the system backward. So all the pi m, I want to express all the pi m as a function of pi 0. So in this case, we get pi 1, we already have pi 1. Pi 1 is just pi 0 over 2. Pi 2 is going to be 1/3 of pi 1. But 1/3 of pi 1 is also 1/6 of pi 0. Then pi 3 is equal to pi 0 divided by pi 3 is here, it's pi 2 over 4. This one divided by 4 is pi 0 over 24. And you recognize here, this comes from this sequence 2 times 3 times 4. This is 2 factorial, 3 factorial, 4 factorial. So in general, you obtain that pi n is equal to pi 0 divided by n plus 1 factorial. So now to conclude the poem, we observe that because this vector is indeed a solution, so here I didn't specify any values for pi 0, but if pi 0 goes across R, this defines a one-dimensional vector space. That's the one-dimensional vector space that corresponds to the set of all the solutions of the system pi p equals pi. Now, if I fix pi 0 equals 1, for instance, this is going to give you a particular solution that corresponds to a stationary measure. Now, to check if indeed there is a stationary distribution or not, and whether the system is positive or recurrent or not, the last thing we want to do is check that indeed we can find pi 0 such that the sum of the coordinates is equal to 1. So in other words, we want to try to find pi 0 such that 1 is equal to the sum for m equals 0 to infinity of pi m. Okay? By sigma dtvd, this sum here corresponds to pi s, that's the total mass of the measure pi. Okay? If the total mass of the measure pi can be made equal to 1 by choosing pi 0 appropriately, then we can deduce positive recurrence. So in this case, we have this infinite sum equals 1 means that the infinite sum for m equals 0 to infinity of pi 0 over m plus 1 factorial equals 1. And here, so you see that the denominator starts from 1 factorial instead of 0 factorial. This looks a lot without the pi 0. This looks like the infinite sum of the 1 divided by n factorial for n starting from 0 that gives you e. Except that now we start 1 after that, and so what I'm going to just rewrite is that this is equal to pi 0 times the infinite sum, but this time starting from 0 in the denominator, so I just shift things a little bit. But by doing that, I add one more term to this sum, and so to compensate, I need to do a minus the first term, which is 1 over 0 factorial, it's 1. And you see that this is equal to pi 0 times e minus 1. And so because E minus 1 is finite, okay, if the sum here was infinite, there would not be any possible choice of pi 0 such that this product is equal to 1, okay? But now because this number is finite, and so which means that, for instance, if you take pi 0 equal 1, then the total mass of the corresponding stationary measure is finite, then you can rescale your vector in such a way that the sum of the coordinates is 1, and that's your stationary distribution. And so in this case, we have that pi 0 times e minus 1 is equal to 1, which tells you that pi 0 should be equal to 1 divided by e minus 1. And if you replace pi 0 by that value in this expression, you indeed obtain a solution to the system pi p equals pi, such that the sum of the coordinates is equal to 1. This is your stationary distribution. So now we can conclude that the time between two consecutive movies, that's the question we want to answer. That's, so we said already that's equal to this mean recurrence time. That's what we want to find. So E0 T0 by the theory that we saw last time, that should be equal to 1 over pi 0. But here we know that pi 0, so 1 over pi 0 is just going to be equal to E minus 1. Okay, which is about, I guess, 2.7 minus 1, it's about 1.7 days in average. And that concludes our problem. So one thing I want to point out again for future problems that you may have to answer is the fact that you never try to compute the mean recurrence time directly. What you do first is study, like try to find the transition matrix to find the stationary distribution. And if indeed you can find a stationary distribution, you have existence of a stationary distribution, then that tells you that indeed your process is positive recurrent, and you can find this value from looking at the reciprocal of the corresponding term of the stationary distribution. So this is the first thing. Never try to find that directly. Find first the stationary distribution, and then you find this vector. And second observation is the fact that if your state space is finite and your process is irreducible, then for free you have positive recurrence and you know that there is a unique stationary distribution. However, when your state space is infinite, the existence of a stationary distribution is not guaranteed. And in this case, you have also to compute pi p equals pi, and then make sure that indeed you can find, in this case that was pi 0, such that this infinite sum is indeed equal to 1. In other words, what you want to make sure is that if you find a particular solution to the system pi p equals pi, you want to make sure that the total mass of this corresponding stationary measure is less than infinity. To make sure that indeed you can divide your particular solution by the total mass to obtain a stationary distribution.